So I just wanted to thank everybody. I wanted to thank Malosi Langa from Psychology. I wanted to thank Peace Kigua from Psychology as well, and Joel Madiri from the University of Pretoria Law School for taking the time to facilitate and also to be discussing in this conversation. So thanks very much and welcome. And can I just do a quick plug for all of you that don't know about the Gender Equity Office? We are here to act against gender-based harm on campus. Please come and talk to us if you have any problems. Please come and talk to us also if you have any ideas about how we can do our work better and how we can get out there more so that people are aware of what we're trying to do in tackling gender-based harm and in toppling patriarchy. Thank you.
So my task is very simple. I'll be chairing this session. But before I introduce Michael, I wish to indicate that in 2006, when I started my PhD on masculinities, I've read a lot of work by Michael Kimmel, and during my PhD, I closely engaged with many of his books. And for me, today, it is such a privilege and honor to be chairing a session in which Michael will be speaking. If you read my PhD, there's a chapter dedicated to his line of work. So you can imagine, when I got the invite to say, would like you to chair the session, I immediately said yes. I will definitely be there. And when you read the invite for this lecture, Why Men Should Support Gender Equality, and I changed the title a bit to say, Why Gender Equality is Good for Men. I had an appointment early this morning, and I shared this with Peace and my other colleagues. As I was about to leave home, I realized that my daughter wasn't feeling well. And that was around past 7, and my appointment was at 8. And then I checked with my partner to say, obviously this child is not well. And she said to me, I also have an appointment at 8. And then we all have appointments at 8. And then it's like, who's going to take the child to the doctor? As a pro-feminist researcher, an academic, and a person who's pro-gender equality, I then said, it is fine, I will take my daughter to the hospital. And I thought by 11 I'll be done. I only finished at 2 o'clock. And when I shared this with colleagues, is that obviously your daughter today had the whole of you. But I think for me, it was quite befitting, given our talk like on this, like on evening.
So let me say that I'm really, really pleased. Is it all right for you? You in front? I'll have to walk around, if that's all right.
That's fine.
Good. So thank you very much. I'm really honored to be here. And let me say a little bit about what I like your change, by the way, of the title. And I also really like the story that you told, because I think not that you did what you did, but that you told the story that you told. And here's why. I think, you know that phrase everybody says, oh, they can talk the talk, but they don't ever walk their talk? I think in many ways, many of us are actually walking our talk all the time, making the kinds of decisions that you made to say, okay, one of us has to stay home. You know, we can flip a coin, or I'll do it this time. But very rarely do men say to their colleagues, this is what I did because of my commitment to family. Right? So I think what we need to do is talk our walk as well as walk our talk. To actually say publicly, yes, these are the choices I'm making. These are really important to me. So let me just say a little bit about what I'm going to talk about. Either title is fine. Basically what I want to do is I want to talk about why men should support gender equality. Or why gender equality is good for us. And actually, that's why men should support gender equality. So that's the end of the talk, because it's good for us. But let me, it's a done deal. That's, we're done. So here, but here's the case that I want to make. I think when men first encounter the idea of gender equality, we have several different reactions to it. One reaction is what you would call the ethical imperative. Gender equality is right. It's fair. It's just. It's democratic. It's what we should do. That's the ethical imperative. Now let me say very clearly, that should be enough, right? It should be enough. I have found that it's difficult. It's not always enough. So there are other ways in which men respond to the idea of gender equality. Another way that we think of it is we invite them to join us. Okay, we get it, gender equality is a good thing, so now we'll set a place for you at the table. Of course, we won't change the menu, we won't change the seating arrangements, but we will certainly welcome you there as long as basically you behave just like us. This is the corporate model, basically, of gender equality. There's another model that says basically, this is very often a response in companies to gender equality when they have like Gender Equality Week or Diversity and Awareness Week. It's sort of like men experience that as Be Nice to the Ladies Week. Okay, we get it. We'll be nice to you for 1 week, and then we get 51 back, right? So that's, you know, and that typically we have in the States, you probably know, we have Black History Month, which is the shortest month of the year. And then we can go back to 11 White History Months, or Women's History Month is March. Again, then we go back to 11 Men's History Months. So that's another way men encounter it. Another way that men respond to gender equality is what I call the cavalry approach. You see in men, the light bulb goes off over their head and they say, yes, gender equality. Thank you, that's a great, and then they begin to mansplain to you your oppression. They basically see themselves as the cavalry coming to women's rescue. They're like the cavalry. They say, thank you so much for bringing this to our attention, ladies. We'll take it from here. This results in a kind of rescuer syndrome, or a syndrome that I like to call premature self-congratulation. And then there's one other way that men respond to it, and that is resistance. And I will come back to that in a few minutes. So these are typically the ways in which men respond to the idea of gender equality, at least in my experience. And you'll notice that there's one thing that's common through all of them, and that is they don't have anything to do with men. It's all about women. It's all about taking care of women. It's all about being nicer to women. It's about including women. It's about rescuing women. But it's never about us as men. When we think in those ways, or it's just right to be nicer to women, but when we think in those ways, we basically take ourselves out of the picture. We don't implicate ourselves. We don't become stakeholders in the question of gender equality. We simply are going to do the right thing. So I think this is the important place to begin. So I want to talk now about the phrase gender equality itself. And I want to talk about the phrase to illustrate two obstacles to engaging men. I'll talk about these two obstacles to engaging men for gender equality, and then I'll talk about how one of the ways in which I think we can make the case to men. So let me take the phrase gender equality. Let's take the first word, gender. Here's the obstacle in engaging men with gender equality around the word gender. Most men don't know that gender matters. Most men don't think that gender is as important to us as women understand it is to them. Most men don't think that gender, if you say the word gender, what gender do you think of? I'm going to go to a lecture tonight about gender. What gender do you think of? Women. Most men don't think about gender. If you teach a course, as I do, like sociology, if you teach a course by sociology of women, you get 95% women in the class. Teach a course called sociology of gender, you get 90% women in the class. Most men don't think gender has anything to do with them. And this is political.
And I'll tell you another story. I was on a TV talk show, one that may be familiar to you. You know, the black female host comes out of Chicago, now owns Weight Watchers, or a significant part of it. And
the reason I'm telling you this story is I want you to hear the title of this particular show. It was a quote from one of these men. And the quote was, "A black woman stole my job." They all told their stories, qualified for job, qualified for promotion, didn't get it, really angry. And then it was my turn to speak, and I said, I have just one question for you guys. And it's about the title of the show, Black Woman Stole My Job. Actually, it's about one word in the title. I want to know about the word my. Where did you get the idea it was your job? Why isn't the title of the show A Black Woman Got the Job? Or Black Woman Got a Job? Because without confronting men's sense of entitlement, we'll never understand why so many men resist gender equality. Because we grew up thinking this is a level playing field. So any policy that tilts it even a little bit, we think, oh my God, water's rushing uphill. It's reverse discrimination against us. So let me be really clear about this. White men are the beneficiaries of the single greatest affirmative action program in the history of the world. It's called the history of the world. So, now I've identified two obstacles to engaging men. The invisibility of gender, which means the invisibility of privilege, and men's sense that gender equality is actually a zero-sum game, and if women win, men are going to lose. I think that's what we encounter. I think that's what we encounter in our classrooms, in our workplaces. And so now I want to turn that, and I want to suggest some of the ways I think we can now engage men for gender equality and get beyond those obstacles. And I have a couple of ideas. But the first is, I'm a social scientist. And I want you to know that I'm basing what I'm going to say now not on some ideological position, but on really good empirical evidence. And that's, I think, the place where I really want to I want to emphasize this. It turns out that gender equality, by all available measures, is good for countries. In one survey, for example, in Europe, the three most gender-equal countries had the highest rates of happiness and the lowest rates of depression among their population. But the three least gender-equal countries had the highest rates of depression and the lowest rates of happiness. Now, those of you who are social scientists, let me be very clear. I am using correlational data. There is no way that I can tell you for sure which caused which. Whether just happier people decided to be more gender equal, or whether the gender equality, but I have a feeling that they're mutually reinforcing. The corporate data, however, is not just correlational. It's gender equality is actually good for our companies. It is good for business. Gender equality, it turns out, is not only good and right and fair, but it's also smart. Companies that are more gender equal have higher rates of profitability. They have better return on investment. They have much lower labor costs because gender. Very often I'm asked by corporate executives, "Oh, gender equality, boy, that's going to be really expensive, isn't it?" And I said, "Oh, absolutely not. Here's what you have to calculate:
how expensive is gender inequality? How much is it already costing you? When women can't, you know, or when you lose women, they have lower rates of productivity. They're less satisfied with their jobs. You have to retrain new people because they keep leaving. The question in many corporations these days is not recruitment, but retention. They can't keep the best female talent that they need and want, precisely because the women, A, experience discrimination, B, hit a glass ceiling in terms of how high they can go, or C, find themselves with policies that don't permit them to be able to balance work and family. So in fact, gender inequality is actually quite expensive. So it turns out it's good for corporations too. But let me now turn to making a more personal case. And this is again based on the evidence. So now I'm going to talk, this is the part of my talk where I'm now going to warn you, this is the most heteronormative I get. But I want to talk for a minute about some research about what makes successful marriages successful. It's really interesting. There's a psychologist at the University of Washington named John Gottman. And he calls himself the marriage doc. He believes, I still find it odd to even say this. So he believes, he's written several bestsellers about what makes a successful marriage. And this is a guy who believes that he can meet a married couple and within 2 minutes, he can tell you if they're gonna get a divorce or not. 2 minutes. This sort of sounds like, you know, the McDonald's drive-thru of therapy. Like it takes 2 minutes. But here's what he has found in his research. Now I have to say, as a social scientist, the question of gender equality, the question of what makes a happy marriage, is actually pretty interesting. Because as sociologists, are any of you sociologists in the room? Okay, so you know, when we do a study of marriage, we only have one variable, intact or divorced, right? Well, he studies successful marriages. All of us know that there are a lot of intact marriages where the couple hates each other. And they could stay together for, well, I don't know, financial reasons, religious reasons, moral reasons, whatever. But he studies the successful marriages. You know, the marriages where the couple still are madly in love with each other. Even they've been married for 58 years, and you can see them walking in the park together, holding hands, and not just for stability. Or you see them at a restaurant gazing lovingly into each other's eyes, and you say to yourself, as anybody would, how do they do it? What makes a successful marriage successful? And here's what Gottman finds. He finds that it's not, for all marriages, it is not only equality in the relationship, but equity, the perception of fairness. Now, for older couples, what he finds is that the perception of fairness may not be exactly equal. You may find many of your parents probably had this kind of relationship, much more traditional. He works outside the home, she takes care of the home and the children. If both people want that, it can be a very happy marriage. That was my grandparents' marriage. But for young people, that is not the model at all. So what he finds for younger people is not so much equity as, in fact, equality. The more equal the relationship, the happier it is, the more likely it is to thrive. So here's the part that gets really interesting. How do you measure happiness in a marriage? How do you measure equality? Well, he came up with two measures across many different cultures. One measure is, can the woman own property in her own name after marriage? So some measure of women's economic autonomy, right? Now, my students, when I tell them this, my students think, well, we've always had that. And I have to tell them that, in fact, it's in my lifetime. I remember going to the bank with my mother. I was 5 years old. And I can remember it because I had to reach up to hold her hand. And I remember walking in the bank with my mother when she was able to open a checking account in her own name without my father co-signing for it. She was so happy. I remember the day. So it's in my lifetime that happened. Second, how much housework and childcare does the father do? Those are the two basic measures. How much housework and childcare does the father do? And can the woman have some measure of women's economic autonomy? And here's the thing that's really interesting about that. This is something that unites most men. Most of the men in the United States, at least, especially most young men, assume and expect to be awesome dads. They assume it. They expect it. They want this. They really expect to be able to, there's no differences. If we ever were from Mars and Venus, we are no longer. Young people want the same thing. They want to have good careers, and they want to have great, you know, good family lives, and they want to be able to balance that. And so we know, how many of you are parents in this room? Okay, those of you who are parents will know that we have this phrase, you probably have encountered this, quality time. Have you bumped into quality time? You're laughing, right? Because it is a complete fraud, right? I mean, you don't get, son, come home early from school on Friday afternoon, we'll go out and kick that soccer ball around. Because you know your kid is going to say, oh, sorry, Dad, I'm busy, but I'll text you. You know, I don't believe in quality time for a second. I believe in quantity time. I believe in doing those routine tasks that nobody gets a medal for, nobody gets to be a father of the year, you just do them over and over again. Quantity time produces quality time. And parents, you'll recognize this. You know, I'll just tell you one more autobiographical story. You know that, you know, parents, those awe moments with your kid, those moments when you feel like you get all gooey and they're, so they don't happen when you try to schedule it. They happen when you say to your kid, when you're watching Toy Story with your six-year-old for the 43rd time, and he leans into you and he says, oh, Daddy, this is so great. I love you so much. Aw. And then you realize this would not have happened had I not watched Toy Story 42 other times. That's what I mean, that quantity time produces quality time. So why should we do this? Why should we share housework? And why should we share housework and childcare? Because here's what the data show. When men share housework and childcare, their children do better in school. Their children have higher rates of achievement, lower rates of absenteeism. They are less likely to be diagnosed with ADHD. They are less likely to be diagnosed with depression, less likely to see a child psychiatrist, less likely to be put on medication. So when men share housework and childcare, their children are happier and healthier and do better in school. Well, maybe that's not enough of a motivation for men. And after all, that's what I want to get to, is why men should do it, because it's in our interest. But maybe that's not enough of a motivation for men. When men share housework and childcare, their wives are happier. Well, duh. Not only that, but their wives are healthier. Their wives are less likely to go to a therapist, less likely to be diagnosed with depression, less likely to see a therapist. They report higher levels of marital satisfaction, they're more likely to go to the gym. So when men share housework and childcare, their wives are happier and healthier. All right, maybe that's not enough of a motivation for men. When men share housework and childcare, the men are healthier. They smoke less, drink less, take recreational drugs less often. They are more likely to go to doctors for routine screenings, but they are less likely to go to the emergency room. They are less likely to be diagnosed with depression, less likely to go to a therapist, less likely to be put on prescription medication. So when men share housework and childcare, the men are happier and healthier. All right, maybe that's not enough of a motivation. When men share housework and childcare, they have more sex. Now, of these four fascinating findings, which one do you think Men's Health magazine put on its cover? Their cover said, housework makes her horny. I don't think they meant when she does it. Now, before I continue, let me just caution the men in the room. These data are collected over a really long time. So I don't want any of the men in here to be saying, I'm doing the dishes tonight. A really long time, okay? But I think it makes a point. And the point is that here's what we already know. I take this as axiomatic. We cannot fully empower women and girls unless we engage boys and men. It is just that simple. Period. Full stop. Tell me one reform that women wanted that didn't require men's support. Let's say the vote. You know, no matter what the reform is, it's always required. We know we have to engage men and boys. So my position on this is very simple. Since we know we have to do that, I think we need to bring men in as stakeholders, as people who believe that this is also in our interest. This cannot be a rescue mission. This cannot be simply because it's right and fair and just, although we know that that should be enough. It's not. So we have to make a case to men that this is in their interest as well. In fact, I think, and this is what where I want to leave us, how am I doing on time? Okay, I'm good. So this is where I want to leave us. I think gender equality is not only not a zero-sum game, but a win-win. It may be, in fact, the best thing that's ever happened for men. Thank you.
I want to start by saying I teach a master's gender in psychology course. And 2 weeks ago, as a matter of fact, we had a reading on masculinities. And we went through a series of readings of Professor Kimmel's. So I must say, just like Malose, this is quite an honor for me to be standing here today. And I see several of my students in the room as well. I will also start with a disclaimer. I have no idea why I've been asked to be a discussant on this particular topic, because I don't ordinarily do research in masculinity studies. For those of you who know me, my research interest is in gender, feminism, more specifically looking around gender sexuality pertaining to LGBTI and women's experiences of gender. But I will give it my best shot. And I will start by trying to think about the South African context. In particular, I'll start by trying to think about two events that happened in April of this year. And you would all know, most those of you who aren't visitors to the country will know about this. The one happened here at Wits during the student protests. And there was a bit of conflict and some physical altercation between student members in the protest, which was specifically centered around gender and queer politics. The other event we all know about, it's what's currently happening at Rhodes University, and that's with the student protests against gender violence and rape and harassment on campus. So I'm thinking about these two events, these very two recent events, but I'm also thinking about quite a bit of slogans that has been made popular with the student protests in Cape Town. And if I can recall correctly, one of those slogans goes, "This movement has women and queers in it." Have you come across that? And that's so interesting to me, because on the one hand, you have quite a momentous time in history where students are speaking up in terms of various rights and fighting for particular kinds of political agendas. But at the same time, you have instances of division within the movement, right? So what you have is gendered politics clashing with racial politics, gender and sexual politics clashing with racial politics. And this is very interesting to me. So what I want to do is try and take the idea of should, right? So I looked at the title, why men should support gender equality. And I want to take that word should and start from the frame of reference that we all know, well, we all think that men should be supporting gender equality. So I'm not going to debate that, all right? But what I want to talk about is what the possible resistances could be to men engaging gender equality. And I'll start with a quote that I came across from Steve Biko, who writes a lot around the Black consciousness movement, and there's one particular line that strikes me. He talks about the importance of the movement and the importance of self-realization. And he ends up with a sentence about why the movement is necessary in terms of a political consciousness raising, and the one sentence he ends up with is this: make the Black man come to himself. Make the Black man come to himself. I've always been fascinated by that quote. So there's particular issues at stake here, and that issue is progressive masculinity. But more than that, another issue at stake is how we critically engage men in terms of developing progressive masculinity. So I want to engage this, the idea of men engaging gender equality, but with a specific focus on black masculinities. I will also assume that we are by now quite familiar with the kinds of theoretical arguments around the social construction of gendered identities, the social construction of sexual identities, and I will not rehearse those. But I want to think about the ways in which it is necessary for us to move beyond this argument, right? If we are indeed to get to the idea of working with or developing progressive masculinities, then surely we need to move beyond rehearsing theoretical arguments around the social construction of gender, right? How do we actually work toward a progressive masculinity? One of my mentors and researchers in the field of masculinity studies, Professor Copano Ratele, he talks about a dead end in masculinity research. And he specifically uses the idea of a dead end because he argues that we've had quite a proliferation of research and work around what it would mean to develop progressive masculinities, different ideas and strategies about how that would work, and yet we are in a country, we live in a country that is known for its high statistics against gender violence against women and children. So we are at a dead end, and the question is, what do we do? How do we move beyond this impasse? Which brings me back to this idea of resistances. How do we engage men for gender equality? I am rooted in feminist thought, and more specifically, I am rooted in black feminist thought. And so what I want to try and think about today is what it would mean to revisit black feminist thought for engaging men in gender equality. Is there something that we can gain from black feminist thought? And one of the arguments I would argue here is that what we need to do is to revisit how we frame black feminist thought, but more than that, reclaim black feminist thought from the typical understandings of feminism as a philosophy, as practice, as research that is rooted in Western contexts. And to start thinking about what it would mean to have conversations with men around the value of feminism for masculinity, the value of feminism for gender equality, the value of feminism for men being part of this conversation. And to do this in a way that reclaims feminism as not exclusively Western, to actually reclaim feminism for African context. So what I really want to argue is, and it's what Professor Kimmel has been saying earlier, is that we need to bring men back into the conversation. That's key. We cannot have struggles and movements around gender equality that is spearheaded by women, that is framed around gender equality for women without thinking about men. Not just thinking about how men could be part of this journey and this conversation, but also thinking about how men have been, in many ways, destroyed by patriarchy itself. So we need a different kind of conversation. But more than that, we need to really interrogate whether or not this is possible. And what I would argue is that much of the feminist work that currently exists has tended to include men in this conversation, but predominantly from a particular angle, and that's the angle of engaging men as perpetrators of violence. So we need to think about different ways we can engage men. We need to think about the different ways in which feminism as practice has in many ways not only excluded men from this conversation, but in many ways has been detrimental to gender equality in society. So that's the one thing. But the other thing I would want to think about is this idea of intersectionality, and this is core to feminist theory. And I want to move away from intersectionality from the typical ways that we tend to think about it, which is it's really just about thinking about multiple identities, and that's important. But I want to argue that there are instances when we tend to depoliticize how we can be intersectional. And so to really think about the ways in which different kinds of identities, in particular gendered identities, intersect with other social categories of identities, but to think about what this would mean for different moments of privilege and oppression. So the ways in which we can be privileged, but also the ways in which we can be oppressed, both men and women. And to really try and work with this. I would argue that in South African context at least, it is a lot easier to galvanize around race than it is around gender and sexuality. And so what we need to do is to seriously think about how we position gender and sexual equalities in society, but more than that, to start thinking about the ways in which this journey towards self-realization that Steve Biko talks about must include an intersection of gender and racial oppression. And so this idea of the invisibility of gender is key. And I'll break away from this for a moment to talk about, like I said earlier, I teach a master's gender in psychology course. I've got only two men in that class. And I remember the first day of lectures, I walk in and students are seated around a table and it's just the one gentleman in the class. And 5 minutes in, a second gentleman walks in and the first gentleman goes, "Oh God, thank God, another man." And we run through the course and at the end of it all, I ask my students what they think about the course offering. And they tell me they were actually surprised to see the way that there would be a kind of focus on masculinity as well, because they hadn't actually conceived of masculinity as something necessary to gender studies. And so it's once again thinking about the ways in which we marginalize men from this conversation. But anyway, I'll talk about an experience in my class. I had a guest lecture. A colleague of mine who does great work on female sex offenders. And I'd asked her to come in to talk about her research during the week we were talking about gender and violence. And she talks about one particular woman, one of her participants in her study, who was currently incarcerated at the time of her interview. And this woman was incarcerated and she was serving a sentence for sexual assault against her 5-year-old son. And she talks about this, but she also talks about this particular woman's personal transition while she's been incarcerated. And she'd formed an intimate relationship with another cellmate. And at the end of it all, one of the students in my class pipes up and says, "I think that's really disgusting." And when we ask her to elaborate, she says she thinks the idea of same-sex relationships is quite disgusting, and she's quite willing to move beyond any kind of offense that this particular woman had committed prior to being incarcerated. So in particular, it's quite okay to have sex with your 5-year-old son, but it's not okay to have same-sex relationships with someone else. Anyway, she said this, and I was quite struck by that, because 5 months into this course, not only had I shared experiences around my own sexual gendered identification, but not until that point, there had been no homophobic sentiment that had been evoked to me by my students. And so that kind of threw me. And I wondered for a moment if that had something to do with my own bodily presentation and how that in many ways could hinder my students being open about their own different gendered and sexual biases. And so what I decided to do was to think about ways that I could bring what it means to be a particular kind of gendered body into the classroom, and to have my students really try and engage with that idea of invisibility of gender. And so I introduced the idea of photonarratives. And to cut a long story short, I'd asked my class to take photographs of what it means to be a gendered body, and to come to class with those photographs and tell a story about their experiences of being gendered. And I'd said to them I would do the same as well. So I came to class with a photograph that I took. I should have brought a picture of that with me. But anyway, it's for those of you who are here at Wits, you would know the tunnel that goes, if you go into the Wits Art Theater, you know the tunnel that you would have to go underneath, right? It's a pretty gloomy tunnel and quite dark, depending on the time of day. On this particular night, I had gone to the Wits Theater with a female friend of mine, and we'd just come out after 12. So it was pretty dark, and we were standing just at the edge of that tunnel, just the two of us, and talking for a while, and we hear a group of voices making their way towards us and getting louder. And as they come closer to us, I can see it's a group of men, and they're quite rowdy, talking at the top of their voices. And only as they get really close to us, I can smell the stench of alcohol. And so now I'm starting, my heart's beating fast. I'm thinking, oh gosh, well, it's just the two of us here, and we have this group of men who are not only rowdy, but are obviously quite drunk as well. And I'm thinking in my head, I'm just going, please walk past, walk past, walk past. And they do walk past, except the one turns back and looks at me and my friend. And I'm thinking in my head, please keep walking, and he stops. Looks at us, he looks at me and points to my friend. And now his mates have stopped as well. He looks at me, points to my friend, and he says, fuck her. Now at the time, this completely threw me. Where in the hell did this come from, and what could he possibly mean by this? And he repeats, fuck her. And his mates now stop and they all look at me and they're all egging him on and saying, yeah, fuck her. And as I'm thinking, trying to make sense of this, it dawns on me, my gender presentation at the time was quite androgynous. And so they obviously thought that I was a man. And so two thoughts are going through my head. I could actually speak up in that moment and give away that I am in fact not a man, or I could play along. And I decided to play along. And so I shrug my shoulders, shake my head, and just let it be. And they keep saying, fuck her, fuck her. And again, I shrug my shoulders. They keep walking and then again stop. And he turns back and says, she's very beautiful, you should fuck her. And again, I shrug my shoulders. And now they keep on, and he turns back finally, and he says to me, get your game on, brah. And anyway, they keep on walking. I tell this story to my students. I bring the photo of that tunnel, and I tell this story to my students because I want them to just have a sense of what it means to occupy space as a particular kind of body. And just to think about what it means to be gendered in a particular way, but more than that, what it means to have privilege, the privilege to occupy space and not even think about it. And we talk about this in class, but I can always see my male students struggle with this. And there are moments when they are able to identify with this idea of invisibility of gender and sexual identity, but there are also moments when they stand outside of that. And throughout the duration of the course, we talk about this idea of the gendered body. I share my stories, they share their stories, but the long and short of this is we are able to come to some kind of understanding of what it means to have privilege, to be oppressed in different ways and in different moments. So the idea of galvanizing around gender and race and racial oppression, I think is key in terms of bringing men back into the conversation. And what I really want to argue here is we need to engage intersectionality, the ways in which our identities intersect with other identities. And more importantly, well, for me, occupying space as a particular queer body, in terms of a queer-raced body, but also a body that shares privilege as a member of staff in this space. I share particular kinds of privileges that a queer body of a student would probably not enjoy. So this idea of intersectionality, I think, is key to feminist theorizing, and I think would be key to thinking about how we are able to engage men in this conversation. And for us to really think about the ways in which masculinity, in many ways, equally shares these differential moments of privilege and oppression. Kopana Ratele talks about the resurgence of African gender traditional identities as well. And he speaks about this resurgence as something that impedes male participation in terms of gender equality. I would also want to argue that part of this resurgence does not engage with the ways in which men are actually hurt by the hegemonic masculinities that tradition, African traditions and cultural traditions in many ways frame masculinity and position men. And so we need to talk about these kinds of vulnerabilities. I want to end up with the idea of what would be our organizing principle? If we had to do this work, what would be the organizing principle in terms of engaging this? It's important to bring men back into the conversation. It's important to engage intersectionality. What would it mean in terms of an organizing principle that incorporates, if we had to do feminist work, we need to incorporate anti-racial work. And if we had to engage racial ideologies, then we also need to engage anti-sexist work. And what I'm really arguing here is we cannot separate this. We cannot separate the ways in which gendered identities intersect with other kinds of identities. And so if we have to try and engage masculinity, if we have to engage men in this conversation to bring the black man back to himself, as Steve Biko talks about, then we would really need to talk about the ways in which we are gendered, but we are also raced, and we are classed in particular ways. We need to talk about the ways in which the kinds of constructs around blackness imprison black men, and also the constructs around masculinity and gender imprison black men as well. And I'll leave it there.
I come to gender or the concern with gender myself as a law student and now a law teacher. I was really bored or really concerned about the way we were teaching law, as though it wasn't linked to issues of power, as though it wasn't linked to issues of race and gender. And so I come to gender and feminist politics with a very strong theoretical and I guess ideological concern. And I draw in particular on feminist work in my concerns. I'm a bit struck listening to Michael Enpeace's really brilliant introductions that I didn't hear the word sexism and I didn't hear the word patriarchy. Probably not once, but that probably has to do with the idea of masculinity studies and the idea of engaging men in these debates. So I'm going to take you to the dark side just a little bit, but I promise to take you back. So I'm going to do two things. I'm going to read a bit from this paper just to make sure I don't get carried away, and then raise one or two provocations in response to the contributions that came beforehand. So, for me, I guess the title of this evening's lecture, Why Men Should Support Gender Equality, reminded me of the famous quote from Mae West, who was an American actress. She said, "Every man I meet wants to protect me, and I can't figure out what from." Now, these words raised for me the problem of enlisting men to support the cause of gender equality when they, or we, have been the core perpetrators and beneficiaries of sexual violence, of women's subordination and the objectification of their bodies, and of the routine gender inequality and double standards we experience in all spheres of life. It was, after all, through feminist politics that we came to understand and confront men as the primary agents, perpetrators, beneficiaries, and symbolic representations of patriarchal power, even though we now know that men do not all benefit from male supremacy in the same way. It was feminists who devoted the labor of exposing the ways in which the dominant worldviews, perspectives, and bodies which were valued and recognized in society, in the domains of family, society, the workplace, religion, the state, the public, and the private, how all of these functioned to perpetuate male dominance and frequently reflected deeply sexist and misogynist assumptions. The hegemony of masculinities and the dominance of men in society, in other words, gets constructed through the making of the world in the image of man, capital M, right? And this is a man constructed through war, constructed through conquest or colonization, constructed through capitalism and the economy, constructed through Christianity, constructed through Eurocentrism, and constructed through heteronormativity. Men or man in the masculine or patriarchal form becomes then the definition of what it means to be human, and woman or the feminine comes to signify non-existence or deficiency. All of us who've done feminism know this, we know how to say this. In the South African context, the perpetuation of patriarchy and sexism in society, that unquestioned privilege, has produced, among others, a tragically high rate of sexual violence, which Pumla Gola, who is giving a lecture on the other side of campus, has named a South African nightmare. So this term nightmare, for me, is evocative about how we should be thinking or describing the structure and consciousness of contemporary violent and hegemonic masculinities. Why then would men, raised and socialized to aspire to and perform the fiction of the real man, have an interest in supporting gender equality? And perhaps even then, the phrasing of the challenge to men has not been, I think, strong enough. For bell hooks, the problem of formulating demands of a radical political movement such as feminism in such terms as gender equality, which is making women the social equals of men, is not just that it inadvertently marks men as the standard or the norm, but that given that men themselves are unequal in patriarchal societies, owing to the conjunctions or intersections of race, class, culture, sexuality, it is unclear exactly which men should be made equal to, which men, women should be made equal to. This idea of gender equality also tends to be associated to a bourgeois feminism, as some people would call it, that has limited itself to legal liberal reforms that merely seek individual inclusion and recognition within male or masculinist structures of power. The core beneficiaries of these kinds of reforms are women who are already empowered in terms of class and race, who purchase their freedom through the subordination of other women, in particular black women who will serve them as domestic workers, amongst other things. In contrast, following bell hooks' definition of feminism as a radical political struggle to end sexist oppression, she would define gender inequality, or gender equality, or the struggle for gender equality in such terms as the revolutionary transformation of society, the eradication of the ideology and practices of male domination. It would involve, therefore, challenging and dismantling the institutional and ideological apparatus that maintains the gendered hierarchies between men and women. And here we can pause to just reflect on the stories. I mean, they were given twice that concern the, let's call them the benevolent husband who would publicly declare that, you know, I took my kids to school instead of my wife. I wash the dishes. I also do some cooking, etc. So what this ideology does is that it marks the figure of the man as benevolent, but it doesn't question the very artifice of the family or the very artifice marriage as heteronormative institutions, as institutions that harbor gender inequality, that both privatize and normalize gender inequality. So for me, it's not so much whether the man chose to wash the dishes or chose to take the child to school. It's the fact that they had the choice, when many women precisely do not. So bell hooks insists on feminism's militant and revolutionary character, suggesting that the pressure to package and formulate feminist demands in a non-threatening way, as many scholars of masculinity with good intentions do want to do, ends up merely supporting the status quo. The big structural ramifications are left untouched in many ways. I think for me, the ethics of this problem is that social change is difficult. Men learning to deconstruct their, our privilege, and overcome their, our sexism and the patriarchal social structures that enable this sexism is difficult. It's not fun, it's not cool, it's not immediately receptible, it's difficult. Men learning to confront their culpability and complicity with sexism, sexual violence, and the degradation of women is also difficult. There is, therefore, no way out of this. And what I often get in the kinds of spaces that are produced by some masculinity studies is that women who quite confidently and assertively insist that issues of patriarchy must be communicated in a radical register often get cast as bad victims because they're not behaving, they're not being reasonable, they're not, you know, they're not following the tone of this calm discourse. Another quote from bell hooks: feminism as a movement to end sexist oppression directs our attention to systems of domination and the interrelatedness of sex, race, and class oppression. It compels us to centralize the experiences and the social predicaments of women who bear the brunt of sexist oppression as a way to understand the collective social status of women. So I worry, I want to say, that masculinity studies, for all its good intentions, its focus on men's role in gender, in ending gender inequality, and its unstated or sometimes quite explicitly stated optimism about men's willingness to undo patriarchy harbors what I think are some depoliticizing and anti-feminist tendencies. And this has to do with the question of why it is that a politics of eradicating inequality ought to even be communicated in a way that is, shall we say, marketable. Not only because these forms of masculinity studies frequently aim to distance themselves from the F word, this time feminism, rather than embrace it, but because it recenters men as heroes and allies without first locating them within the patriarchal social structure or without keeping them in that social structure long enough to understand the problem. It thereby risks invisibilizing, I think, feminist work and feminist efforts by women on how male subjectivity gets formed through the erasure of the absence of the figure of women. I think of this title, he for she, and just if one thinks of it semantically, the he is both the primary and active term. It is for, so the he is moving, the he can transcend, but the she is still and is available to the for of the he. So even that kind of language is already problematic. It doesn't, I think, get to the heart of the problem. And the obscenity of this is most clear for me whenever I think of whites for blacks or if whites were saying similar kinds of things about racism. As I see it, our task as pro-feminists or male feminists or male advocates of gender equality is to draw on the voices, the experiences and knowledge of women and feminists in order to engage other men about the ethical and political necessity of a revolution in the way we live as men and the way we relate to women, to other men and to the world. I wonder also, given the unraveling of the category of gender in recent years, first through the exposure of its intersection with race and class, and then through forceful and necessary insistences on trans, queer, and gender non-conforming bodies, not to mention also, and this is a problem that must be stated because of the problem of ideology, women's own well-documented participation in upholding patriarchy. I wonder, given the fact that this category that we call gender has now become so unstable, so as it were, troubled, whether the strategy of simply engaging men is still relevant. In other words, are those the primary sites of antagonism as far as gender is concerned? I'm not sure anymore, precisely because the category men and women, the category he and she, are so unstable nowadays. I think there's still a case to be made for the more mature an avowed feminist strategy of consciousness raising, of working together with the awareness of our privilege, our history, and our location to bring about a world without imperialism, violence, economic exploitation, and hierarchy. So I think we need to historicize gender. We need to historicize, in particular, the relation in Africa between gender and culture, because some of the scholarship that goes by the name masculinities, exposing traditional African culture as patriarchal, suffers from a serious civilizational delusion in which what is Western is always free and what is African is always unfree. And there's a lot that's problematic about that, but that's precisely the loss of a historic angle. Hooks again, feminism is the struggle to end sexist oppression. Its aim is not to benefit solely any specific group of women, any particular race or class of women. It does not privilege women over men. It has the power to transform in a meaningful way all our lives. I was very excited, but also scared piece when you mentioned the need to turn to black feminism, because I think a lot of the problems you posed about feminism as having excluded men, et cetera, I don't think is the case, particularly in the black feminist tradition, where black feminism had to be forged in the site of racial struggle, understanding men as brothers, but also as complicit in sexual violence. So I actually think the resources in feminism are much richer than we give credit for. So I absolutely don't think masculinity is a progression of feminism. In fact, I think it owes so much to feminism, it might as well call itself that. The question of why men should support gender equality for me, therefore, is inseparable from the need to return to what has elsewhere been called by Drusilla Cornell, by bell hooks, and other feminists, the revolutionary praxis of feminism. Feminist thought has come a long way from the old binary of women as victims and men as the enemy, even though men do oppress women, and the fact that men are also trapped in rigid gender roles does not change this fact. As bell hooks reminds us, feminism is a movement that allows people of all genders, all sexes, all sexualities, boys and girls, to participate in revolutionary struggle. Indeed, hooks imagines men as comrades in struggle. And in this way, she sets the bar, I think, much higher than simply asking men to support gender equality on the grounds that it benefits them too. She invites men to build bonds of solidarity, to struggle for self-recovery and liberation, and ultimately to take responsibility for transforming their consciousness and transforming social relations as a whole. In other words, women and men in this conception of feminism comes out of bell hooks's work, are moral and political agents. You don't need to market anything to them, but you do expect them to struggle ethically with these problems. The return to feminism for me then involves men unlearning sexist ideology, giving up their roles as oppressors and beneficiaries of interpersonal and structural sexism. So on that score, we're all in agreement about the importance of engaging men. But the problem with a campaign like He for She is that rather than disturbing male power, it appeals to the benevolence of powerful male celebrities, politicians, and academics, and reinforces many paternalist patriarchal tropes, men as heroes, men as protectors, and turns away from the nightmare, invoking that word again, the nightmare that is patriarchy and sexual violence. I want to conclude roughly by saying that in her book on Clint Eastwood and the issues of American masculinity, the ethical feminist Drusilla Cornell figures masculinity actually not as stable, not as in control, but as quite tragic and self-destructive, associated as it is with the virtues of violence, of a false omnipotence and revenge. She suggests from a feminist perspective the need for men to give up the fantasy of phallic control and uprightness. She suggests the struggle to become a good man means coming to terms with finitude, with humility, with limitation. And just to close, she refers to South African literary scholar an academic, Njabulo Ndebele's phrase, which he calls to give up certitude. So maybe let me read that, because for me, the whole idea of thinking about men and gender equality involves the question of giving up certitudes. And he says, he was asked a question around certainty, and he responds by saying, I have reflected much on this. What seems to happen in this situation is that at the point at which you recognize mutual vulnerability between yourself and an adversary that will not go away, you signal a preparedness to recognize that there might be new grounds for a common humanity whose promise lies in the real possibility that you may have to give up something that has defined your reality, handed down from a past that cannot entirely meet your best interests now and in the future. It is the humility that arises when you give up certitudes around what was previously the uncontested terrain of your value system and unsustainable positions derived from it. It is the willingness to embrace vulnerability of the kind that faces you when you learn to unlearn, because there is so much more that is new to learn. Your new sense of comfort comes from the confidence that others who are on the opposite side are doing so too and are also experiencing vulnerability. It is about the capacity of abandoning certitude. Thank you.
Mine is to say that patriarchy, Prof, will agree with me, is not only limited only to a political sphere, but is broadly in society as a whole, in terms of areas like politics and economics. Because if you found that now in Africa, especially, or in internationally, how many policymakers like MPs, ministers, prime ministers who are women? Very little. That to me sounds like it's a gender operation. You know, very, very few. Even in the private sector, it's only male world that are getting promotions and incentives. You know, the only country in Africa that can claim that we are more advanced than even compared to the first world is South Africa. Because there are many, many women who are MPs in parliament, and also who are ministers, you know. So the government can't intervene in someone's sphere, the private sector. In someone's sphere, it's not the government terrain. It's the companies, they are on their own, no? The government can't tell them, hey, you NetBank or whatever, do this, you know? Yeah, before I conclude my clarity and come questions, Professor, I would say also, socially, even you find that, you know, coming to your churches, you know, religions, Catholic Church. They don't allow up until this hour a female become a father or a priest. It's only male allowed. You know, the Pope all these years was a male, no female. No, that's to me a gender oppression. You know, to go to Islam also, it's very few Muslims, female who are, it's like equivalent to Molana, you know, a reverend. Very, that's also a gender being bias, you know, prejudices. Finally, finally, I will also appeal to this to you, Prof, also, and also to the people here from South Africa, that the question is, will it make sense to us to say to us as a part of gender empowerment to make, in history in this country, making a Zuma successor a female, preferably as one being untipped in Nkosazana Zuma, his ex-wife, as a history making, you know? Like in your case in America, we have made a history by making the first black African president, Obama, no? Suppose this is related to your case also in America, in our case, whereby you want to make Hillary Clinton as a part of, to me sound like, as a part of gender empowerment, to make a female president in the history of the USA. So us also here, we are facing that same question. Is it a dilemma, or is it a truly empowerment of a women?
Okay, I just want to thank you all for a really fantastic panel. This is super, super, super interesting, and it's really interesting to see the perspectives that you all come from. And the first thing that I want to do is point to something that, you know, you've all suggested, which is like, you know, intersectionality is such a buzzword on this campus at the moment. It's everything, you know, it comes up every 5 minutes. But just to repeat the fact that it's really important, and that the way in which we talk about gender and the way in which we talk about race are so deeply, deeply intersected. There's no way of dividing them, and that, you know, so much of the stuff that you guys have been discussing, you talk about the way that men behave in certain types of male privilege, is exactly comparable to the sorts of conversations that we also have about whiteness and white privilege and this sense of entitlement, which, by the way, is, you know, the deepest irony, because white people are always talking about how black South Africans are so entitled. It's annoying. There is that thing, right, that keeps coming back, that we need to be able to think about gender and race in the same ways. We need to be able to think about masculinity and about whiteness and those forms of privilege in similar ways. And I think my question to you is, how the hell do we actually do anything about this? Because as a lecturer at this university, you know, I've had the same experience with groups of male students that I've had with groups of white students, where entire semester's worth of discussion and argument and, you know, like conversation around these issues and around how we decenter privilege and rethink about privilege have then ended up at the end of that class with a group of white students saying, no man, but we must all be colorblind. You know, once we're colorblind, everything will go away. Or a group of male students going, well, you know, if women stop distracting us from the struggle, we could get on and make everything okay. And it's like, you work really, really, really hard as an educator to introduce these ideas and create critical spaces for them. But then because you're an educator in a department that, you know, in my case is largely, my student body is largely female, the men in my classes, in a lot of cases, they don't listen. I don't know whether they're listening. I can't say, I'm not in their heads, but they don't respond. And when it comes time for them to feedback, they haven't necessarily taken in what's been happening because they feel isolated and alienated by being in a space that's largely female. But it's only in spaces that are largely female where these conversations are even happening. How the hell do you construct conversations that actually engage people in ways where they don't feel, you know, isolated, alienated, left out? And I, you know, you're all giving really strong theoretical and critical explanations of how this can work and why it's important. But I think what we always come up against is the actual day-to-day practicalities of what we do, particularly on Wits campus.
I think the struggle for gender equality, I'm a little bit skeptic because it's a noble struggle, but it's being undertaken in a wrong setting. I mean, the liberal setting is wrong because this setting is about clashing interests that are promoted, competitiveness. It's like a jungle. And why am I saying this? It's because within such a setting, men will never accept to relinquish their privileges. Because it's competition, it's jungle. Once we relinquish, women will take over and it will become matriarchy. From patriarchy, an extreme to another extreme matriarchy. We cannot afford to relinquish our power in such a setting. So, good cause in a wrong setting. What I propose then is to add to the notion of freedom, to the value of freedom, a greater one even, which is love. We never talk much about love. I mean, the spiritual one. People are talking negatively about religion, about, for example, Christianity. But the master himself of Christianity said, there is no greater love than to lay down your right for others. So meaning, I have to sacrifice myself for, as a man, for the women, my partner, my wife, my daughter. That is it. Meaning we should be spiritual. This cause can be successful in a spiritual setting, I mean, even political setting. And since we've ignored spirituality, since we've been slaves of Darwinian socialism, there is no hope that we'll overcome this. Either we'll turn from patriarchy to matriarchy, or patriarchy will remain. So it needs, it's up to us now as academics to think about a new setting, a spiritual one.
So first, I think that the question about patriarchy, my lack of clarification, and by the way, I counted at least two times that I mentioned it in my talk, just to throw that out there. There's two ways of measuring it. One, of course, is the number of actual women in those political positions, and that's a kind of numbers-driven question, but it doesn't get at the systemic relationship between groups. So it seems to me that what we're looking at when we talk about patriarchy, we're not talking simply about the number of embodied people in positions of power, but the way those positions of power are organized, the way economic structures articulate with state structures, with cultural traditions, so and then also interactively the relations between and among groups. So there's a lot of different levels that we would talk about, I think, if we were going to really analyze patriarchy, which was not my intention, but I think that's so I'm sensitive to the numbers question. And I think, I personally believe that if I woke up tomorrow and every political position, my panelists might disagree with this, but I believe that if I woke up tomorrow and every single position of power in the world, every corporate board, every CEO, and every member of parliament in every country in the world were a woman, I would feel better about it. I'd sleep better at night. Now, that doesn't attach, that simply is numbers driven, remember, but I think it would do some different, it would be different. Now that's not to say that the structural, the interconnectedness of all these structural levels is of course dominant and important and sort of the overdetermining force. But I could deal with the numbers too. And that leads to my second answer, I think. And that is the kind of, nobody is suggesting, I think, I'm not suggesting, that we replace patriarchy with matriarchy, but rather something where all of us, I think, looking for some way to encourage greater gender equality in our personal relationships and in the institutional arrangements that we have. So I don't think that that's really a question of replacing one form of domination with another. Although, again, I wouldn't mind it, but that's personal, that's not political. But the question of where, what we do, there's two things here. The first is, I want to respond a little bit to what Joel said, because I didn't quite understand, and I'm going to ask you to explain this to me, the critique that you had of masculinity studies as somehow overly optimistic. I think, and you use that phrase, and I'm not quite sure I understood it, so I'm going to ask you to explain it. I have to say, I'm very optimistic. I'm optimistic because I'm an activist, and I believe that change is possible. How could you be an activist and not believe this? And secondly, because I'm a teacher, and I believe that if I can encourage my students to engage more critically with the world they live in, their lives will be better for it. That's optimistic. I've never understood why the academy is so loaded with cynics. I think we are engaged in a most optimistic profession, and so I'm very optimistic. That said, I think our differences then are strategic, right? How do we answer the question of how we engage people at the entry point? My job is not downstream. My job is to talk to people at the first instance, to open a door into a conversation that women have been having for 40 years that men have basically thought didn't have anything to do with them. So I'm not interested. I mean, I'm certainly interested in the downstream, the deepening, the theoretical. But what I feel is once they get in the door, they have the rest of their lives to make it more complicated. But I have to get them in the door in the first instance. Mm-hmm. So by telling them, this is about you, your life might be better for it, is a way in. Shouldn't have to be. I established that very early on. The ethical imperative should be enough. But so the question about how we do this is, I think we have to point out, and this is something that you mentioned, how does patriarchy, how does gender inequality disfigure our lives? How does racism distort white people's vision in the world? How does it distort men's view of themselves, of others, through sexism? Seeing through that lens, so getting them to just take off the glasses for a moment in imagination, is enough to say, you have a place in this conversation. You are not the leader of this conversation. You're not rescuing anybody. Mm-hmm. I share some of your concerns about the name he for she, but Pumzile will not be moved off of that. I guarantee it. It was her idea. It was her name. And she has heard every single bit of feedback about it. Not going to change. So our job then is, okay, we have to make our peace with this. She's not going to move on this. And the symbol, equally problematic. But again, we do what we can with what we have, and we try to move it a little bit. This is my optimism. I believe it would be imperialistic of me to ask of my students that they start their journey with the same level of sophistication that I hear on this panel. That would be, and every time I go to a conference, there's always some guy who's just heard feminism for the first time, just heard the idea, and he always will say, he'll say something after, hopeful, like, I've just learned about this. And of course he's gonna say something stupid, right? And everyone's gonna jump on him, and he never comes back. I think we do I think that's a mistake. Mm-hmm. I'm not talking about the theory that we have. Mm. I'm talking about the political strategies we adopt. Mm. I cannot expect people to be as sophisticated as you are when they first start. That would be unfair, that would be a violence to them. So I feel like I have to take people where they are and begin to work with the concerns they have. So when I hear these guys say, you feel victimized, let's talk about that. Let's talk about how all the power in the world did not trickle down, we like that word, to you feeling powerful. How come it didn't work out for you? How come all this patriarchal power actually didn't work? Like, how come, so you're gonna get more? Maybe try a different strategy, right? So that would be my response to this, is you take people where they are, not where you think they should be. This is my position as an educator, I have to say. I wish my students, were as brilliant as my colleagues. But my colleagues have been studying for 30 years, and they've been studying for a day and a half. So I can't expect that. I can't expect that sophistication. But once they're in the room, they have the rest of their lives to make it more complicated. And I think, and so my job is to say, here are the entry points: fatherhood, friendship, relationships with women, relationships with other men, thinking about yourself and your job, all of these sorts of things. These are potential entry points. And that's really a strategic difference, not an ideological one. And just one more PS, since you invoked her so many times, Joel. You remember the story about the group, the black woman and the white woman?
That was Bell.
The black
Hooks.
Woman was Bell.
Ah.
Was Gloria Watkins. We were students together, so just thought I'd mention that. She pushed me around too, very quite personally.
I find the words, and I mean, I don't think optimism and pessimism are always the right words. When I said masculinity studies exhibits an optimism about the possibility of men's involvement in the struggle for gender equality, I meant, as in the case of whiteness studies, the assumption that you can morally persuade someone after having exposed the evil, right, that they will simply stop. But you could exacerbate it by showing the deep interests involved in living in a patriarchal society and the benefits of living in a patriarchal society. So in that sense, I think that there's optimism there. I mean, we know the evils of patriarchy. I think men who beat their wives up and see the wounds, and men who kill their wives and have to read about their funerals know the harm. The point is therefore not moral persuasion. It's the fact that we live in a social order in which this has become normalized. And so moving it away from only or primarily behavioral project to thinking about the larger structural politics immediately is absolutely important. So maybe the difference is just strategic. Just want to say something else about optimism. Two wonderful books, but the one I'll mention is by Lorraine Berland. She has this book called Cruel Optimism. It's a whole study of the ways in which certain forms of optimism can become fatalism and can become complacency with the status quo. So in that sense, if I think of myself as a dark thinker or a pessimist, what I mean is I'm well aware and I refuse to deny how dark the times are. But I know that, and the reason I still talk about it is that those times can still be held back. So my worry about certain forms of optimism is there's something too sanguine, something too sweet, something too sentimental, something that doesn't admit the nightmare that I find problematic.
I'm going to collate all three responses. Just a note, the first speaker who talked about patriarchy not be limited to a single sphere, I think that's indisputable, but I'll just want to point out that we should be very worried about talking about political gains made in the country as an instance of gender equality. So talking about how many female MPs we might have in parliament, that's great, but what would really need to push this conversation is the kinds of translation to the ground level. So for instance, even if you think about the ways in which both men and women are invested in particular kinds of social relationships that actually reinforce the patriarchal system. I think many of us here cannot discount the role of the ANC Women's League in terms of pushing particular kinds of gendered agendas that are actually detrimental to women's liberation. Nikki, your question is a very difficult one, the idea of how we actually engage. And it's very difficult for me because I have generally tended to approach my teaching from the framework of bell hooks. So this idea of a pedagogy of hope, I always return to. And I suppose what the way I think about it is that in order to continue to do the kind of work that I do, I have to remain rooted in the idea of hope. I have to believe that it is possible, not just for my students, but for some kind of critical consciousness to emerge. It may not emerge in that moment, it may not emerge by the end of the course, but I have to believe that it will. And so if I have to engage a pedagogy of hope, I also have to engage a pedagogy of disruption. Because I think it's very important that we disrupt. That's the only way that learning is possible. And what that would mean is that, well, I'm a psychologist, so I always have to engage the affect and emotions. But I think what that means is that we have to be very attentive to the ways in which every single one of us, not just our students, but also ourselves as teachers, are embroiled in a relation, in a process of investments, psychological investments that make it impossible to learn at particular moments. So this idea of resistance, why would we resist particular kinds of relationships, particular kinds of status quo, and to really think about the investments that we make. And so one of the things that I try to think about in terms of how would I actually try to navigate this barrier that lies before me, and I have to come back to the idea of dialogue. Dialogue is important. Dialogue in the classroom. And that would mean listening to the voices that we wouldn't ordinarily listen to, but also listening to the kinds of investments that are actually in direct opposition to just about everything that we stand for. And engaging them in a way that is not detrimental, as Prof. Kimmel says, to further learning. And I have come to learn, and this is me occupying a position of being a teacher, is that there are actually moments when in that conversation I need to shut up and listen. And so I suppose the roundabout way that I'm trying to answer you is that we never know. We can never really know for certain that we are making a difference in the classroom, but we remain hopeful, right? And just the last gentleman, I really like that you talk about love and spirituality. I think that is a conversation that has kind of been thrown out of much political conversation, particularly feminism. And I think we need to bring those conversations back in, funny enough. And the way I would think about it is that gender equality needs to be met head on, not just in terms of the macro. So we definitely need these. It's great that we have this, the constitution that we do. We need these kinds of structural responses to gender equality. But we need to engage the subjective. We need to engage the micro. And part of that is thinking about the ways in which our souls have actually been destroyed by the system that we find ourselves, both men and women. We need to talk about love. I agree.
A few things. So about Nkosasana Dlamini Zuma as president, or just the idea that one of the ways you empower subordinated groups is by placing them in high positions. The whole history of the phenomenon that we call black faces in high places has shown us that that has been a dismal failure. The expectation that having a black man as president, both in the United States and South Africa, has been a way of changing fundamental structural social relations simply has not worked, and I suspect the same will be in the United States should they appoint Hillary Clinton, who bell hooks would call a war criminal, becomes a president. So I think we should just be careful, and that's maybe what I'm trying to think about is, on the one hand, there's our gendered position in the world, but on the other hand, there are our political, ideological identifications, and we ought to be careful not to always confuse those. And I think about the gender studies classroom, or I think about my legal philosophy class, and a lot of my assumptions is when I'm teaching critical race theory, I'm really doing it to get the white students to change their mind. When I'm talking about feminism, I'm talking to the men. But in both cases, I'm often surprised about the conservative members of the subordinated groups, women who deny and completely reject the claims of feminism. Now, I have to, as an educator, give some kind of respect and integrity to that starting point. And not assume, so I can't always assume that I'm only speaking to men. So I try to teach what Jacques Rancière would call universal teaching. I assume that we are all open to the question of what it means to be different in the world. And so I don't have those kind of starting points because I think they can be really risky. And often one or two students come back at the end of the semester and say, you know, this was an interesting course, or what can I do as a man? What can I do as a white person? And I think we should claim small victories because we should understand that we are not students only teachers. They are adults. We live in a world of mass neoliberal mass media. They have families where they come from, religions. They have hidden and explicit curriculums. They are taught not only by me, but by many other conservative white males. So we have to understand those complexities. We are not going to produce revolutionaries in one gender course or in one critical theory course. But what we can do is lay the foundation theoretically through knowledge. But sometimes I think if we overinvest in experience, what happens is they think the experience is all they've got, or that's the only place to stay. Mm-hmm. So we've got to talk about how knowledge, we can be transformed through knowledge and dialogue. Mm-hmm. So those are some strategies. I don't think there's a strategy. I think it's a pedagogy of experimentation in classrooms. It all depends. Mm-hmm. The final thing is about political spirituality. Of course, bell hooks has a book called All About Love. Love has been central to her thinking about feminist revolution. So for feminism to be revolutionary politics is precisely because it places love at the center. Mm. But she shifts love away from the interpersonal and the sentimental. And for her, love is precisely the materialization of justice, right? Mm. In social relations, public and private. So that love, because, this is the problem. Thomas Jefferson loved Sally Hemings, you know, but she was still a slave. And he was still a slave owner. So that we've still got the problem of power. So love is precisely thinking of social relations where power hierarchies aren't needed for us to make sense of our identities. Mm-hmm.
One of the things that I think, at least for me, was highlighted in this discussion is the ways in which we kind of have to rethink concepts of self-interest, right, in terms of our self-interest always detrimental, or is there a way in which to rethink self-interest as actually a starting point from which we can actually move forward in a revolutionary way that I think you're highlighting, but also to kind of rethink the concept of revolution in long term rather than simply thinking that we're going to change men today or right away, because we can talk about all kinds of changes that have not materialized in ways that we've assumed. Yeah. But the whole point that I'm trying to get at here, which goes back to, I think, the gentleman's thing there, is that I do research on masculinity and religions. So looking at men's religious movements and kind of looking at the ways in which how men's religious movements thinking about self-transformation in relation to religious concepts actually might become useful for social transformation processes. So we look at promise keepers in the US. They're problematic in one sense, but they also got men thinking about themselves as agents for change rather than just subjects to change. So in the sense I'm saying, how can we, and I think this is what is being highlighted, how can we rethink normative concepts around politics in ways that start from the ground up rather than from the traditional kind of hierarchical model? And I think from that sense, we can think about the man who says, I'm going to wash dishes today. That's a starting point rather than, oh, this is a demilitated understanding of transformation. And I think depending on where you start, you might get somewhere much stronger. So that's all that I just wanted to kind of share that. For me, that's kind of what this discussion has highlighted.
So, I mean, I think the best thing about tonight for me was the stark differences in the three panelists that we had. I mean, we started from a very sort of Western view, and then we came from a Africanist view, then we came from more of a view that I come from, which is transcending beyond categories of difference. So my question comes more, how do we start conversations where we understand gender and the gendered space as a place that we make meaning in? And in that meaning making, there's commonalities and there's differences and there's shared experiences. And purely from that perspective, I struggle to harmonize any category, the category of patriarchy, the category of blackness, the category of whiteness, not invalidating the political importance and the political weight of those particular categories. So I suppose my question is, you know, I feel like as an academic as well, I do this, that I privilege difference, you know? I privilege difference against totality. So I almost feel like I must always talk about difference in specific categories. And I think this is a bit reductive because you always do this when we keep the opposition in place. So I suppose the question is, how do we get the dialogue to move on using these particular type of spaces where we don't invalidate the political weight of the categories, but we force ourselves to actually think beyond them and to actually take commonalities of experience in their political sense and in their particular contextualities in asking ourselves questions about gender, femininities, and masculinities. So I suppose it's about like reifying difference. You know, we reify difference assuming heterogeneity. We always want to talk about LGBT, or you're always going to talk about women or men or Afros or blackness and whiteness. So it's about really like problematizing the self-other relation and how as human beings we relate to each other, because it's an impossible space. And the very fact that that space is marked with difference means that we are prone to prioritizing a particular type of difference when you talk about anything that's particularly categorized. I hope I'm making sense. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure if it's not actually a question for the space. I think it's a broader question of, you know, how do we take these dialogues and then we move beyond what we just did here in terms of really coming down to the questions of the complexities of differences to begin with.
I guess, and I'll just move to closing remarks. We might need to learn to live with political disunity, and by that I mean to simply live with the fact that the answers to the questions of our time are not easy, and that many times we think we've solved the problem and it turns out the problem takes on new iterations and new formations. Some of the theories around gender and sexuality and feminist revolution that I think are most illuminating are not always practical or easily implementable. But also some of the solutions that are easy, that are marketable, are quite theoretically problematic. And often we have to make different kinds of choices based on the disciplines we come from, based on the worlds we inhabit, based on whether we see ourselves as academics or as activists, about what kind of difficult choices to make. And those difficult choices are not reducible to the theoretical. So absolutely, critique is about opening up. It's not a rejection. I'm highly worried about the kinds of initiatives that have followed masculinity studies and he for she and so forth. But absolutely, you're right, it's a start and it's the beginning and an opening up. And so there are many debates there. I'm still very worried. So I think that's what it means to live with disunity, to know that these worlds we inhabit are complex and that the solutions aren't that easy. I want to say something else about the tension between theory and practice that came out. I do want to always, and again, maybe this is the academic in me, caution people against easy solutions, or what Amika Gabral called easy victories. I think we should be careful not to think that every initiative or policy that goes by the name gender equality is necessarily good for gender equality. It could be problematic. 10 years later, we could think, wow, that was a big mistake. And I think we should be open to realize that sometimes what gets called practice is not always the best thing for now. I think we are at a moment where we need to think about the powers that organize the space that we inhabit, and to really get to grips with where we are in time. And so I'll end there.
For the sake of time, I'll just really hone in on the last speaker's question, and I'll hone in on it, and I'm not sure that I'm fully going to answer your question, because it's something that I am continuing to grapple with. But I've really been fascinated with this idea of difference and how we can work with difference. And how we do not privilege that. And what's really interesting to me, and this has come about the previous year with the student fees must fall protests, is this idea of black pain, for example. And I've had a number of colleagues and friends say to me, it's very important that we hear these stories, but really now, these students are kind of making a mountain out of a molehill in the sense of trying to essentialize black pain, right? And I have grappled with that because I understand the importance of in many ways making visible what's always been invisible, right? And kind of speaking to that. But how is it possible for us to speak about our experiences, our identities, our pains, our hurts, in a way that does not imprison us in those categories, in those experiences? And I think that's the core of all of this. So how do we engage difference? And for me, there's different ways that I think we can think about this. I think we always need to come back to the force of affects, the force of emotion. We have to acknowledge pain. We have to acknowledge experiences. We have to make these visible. We have to vocalize this. We have to give voice. But we have to be very wary about essentializing these accounts, these experiences, these identities in ways that make it impossible for us to move beyond them. Now, where I'm not going to answer your question is how we do that, because I have no idea. I have to tell you. But I really do think that we need to give voice to all of these and at the same time be careful of imprisoning ourselves in these identities and these experiences. So it's an ongoing quest for me. I've.
First of all, I think this was a really interesting, exciting, and sort of stimulating conversation for me, and so I appreciate my fellow panelists and also the questions that have been asked. I have a couple of responses. Again, I come to this as an activist, and as well as an academic, and I really have tried throughout my career to remain in a dialogue between those two. So when I hear Joel, for example, say, well, you know, not every initiative is going to be a good initiative, and you might find 10 years down the road that it wasn't a good one, I'm thinking, yeah, but you tried. You can't have the critique before the action. Well, it's not going to work because this and this and this. I think you have to try. And I believe, for example, that black faces in high places has not been a dismal failure. Gina Davis says, if you can see it, you can be it. I think when we elect our first female president in the United States, which we will, I guarantee it. It will be a rout, by the way. I believe that it will be really terrific in one respect, at least in one respect. There will be millions of little girls who will say to themselves, I can do that. And even if there are Hillary Clinton has big problems, we agree on this, we don't disagree. But there are going to be girls out there who are way better than her, and they're going to see that that's possible for them. And I would never say that Obama has been a dismal failure in any way. I think he's been one of the most successful presidents we've had, despite the fact that he's faced a wall of the most intransigent opposition and overt racism that I've seen in my lifetime. So I don't think it's been a dismal failure at all. I think we need to see those faces in those places. But I don't think that's the end. That's a means. That's a beginning. I'm not thinking about them in those positions. I'm thinking about my kids. I'm thinking about their kids, to see that as possible. So that is important to me as an activist. And as an activist, I will also say that one of the things that I find really hopeful and also troubling is the fact that I work with a coalition of 700 NGOs around the world called Men Engage. These are programs all over the world that are trying to engage men for gender equality, whether it's about healthy boyhood, involved fatherhood, women's reproductive rights and health, or violence against women, or in the case of probably the best known organization in the world, that's Sanke, trying to raise awareness around health and reproductive rights, sexuality, and violence, all of which are quite intertwined in South Africa in ways that I couldn't pretend to begin to understand. But I do find them tremendously inspiring. So I think, and I fear sometimes that we get in that, you know, the dismal failure question. I think that's what happened, for example, to Carly Fiorina when she was CEO of Hewlett-Packard. You know, the company did badly, and they say, oh, we tried it once, didn't work out, and there will never be a woman CEO again. I don't think we can call these things dismal failures. They're steps in a process. So I really want to push back against that category, because then we won't try it again. So Barack Obama will be our last black president. Or Hillary Clinton would be our last female president, and that would be a tragedy to my mind. And the last thing I want to say is I want to say something about love, because I want to conclude with it, because I think you're quite right to bring it up. I think sometimes the way we get set in this conversation is about men and women. And I think we forget, I'm not a psychologist, but I have to tell you, both my mother and stepfather are psychoanalysts. So I'm the adult child of psychologists. But I'm in recovery, sociology, I think we often forget that men also exist in relationships, and it's in those relationships that I think we can begin to appeal to them. Every man in this room knows what it feels like to love a woman and want her to succeed. Everyone, because we're not just men; we're sons. We're fathers, we're grandfathers, we are brothers, we are lovers, we're partners, we're friends. All of those relationships are positive relationships. We know what it feels like. I want to politicize that love. I want to bring that feeling that we already know what it feels like, but I want to make it public. That's why I was saying talk your walk before. Mm. Not just do it and quietly, but do it publicly, loudly, to say, this is how you do this. This is how we love, is by doing things that would be promote greater equality. So I completely agree, share with you that concern that we often forget the effective side, because I think that's a point of entry for men. They already know what that feels like. So thank you all very much.